1971, a small New York record label pulled together its best artists for a performance at a club in the city.
Ladies and gentlemen, here they are, the world's greatest black musicians, the Fania All-Stars!
2 years later, they performed for over 40,000 people at Yankee Stadium. 1 year after that, they were playing for thousands more across the globe. By the end of the 70s, the label, Fania, had sold millions of records around the world. All the while, back in the US, most people barely noticed. This is the story of what they missed. A musical revolution. The birth of salsa. The 1960s in East Harlem, El Barrio. By then, the city held over a half a million Latinos, mostly Puerto Ricans. Many were young, part of a massive post-war generation whose search for identity would transform U.S. culture. New York-born Puerto Ricans would become New Yorkicans, and salsa would be their flag. The first step on that journey was away from the Latin big bands of the 50s.
I was tired of traditional Latin music. I was tired of bands and frilly dresses and perfume, heavy musky perfume. I was tired of that. We grew up immersed in it, and it's like your mother and your father. You're used to them.
A one, a two, a one, two, three.
We had a rock and roll generation that was listening to Smokey and the Miracles, The Temptations, Elvis Presley. Rock and roll knocked us out. And it knocked us out as much as it did any other American.
It didn't take long for musicians in El Barrio to make R&B and rock their own. They called it Latin Boogaloo, a fusion of traditional Latin rhythms and the new sounds of a new generation.
If you listen to that, what you hear is you hear kind of a funk and the very bottom of rhythm and blues. See? And then the rest of it is the Latin rhythm on the bottom. But it was just putting the music together, the sounds that you were raised with. And as a kid from El Barrio, born in El Barrio, you know, it just came out.
It filled the void because we had nothing. We were caught between rock and roll and Latin. It married the two.
Earlier hybrids had made it to the pop charts, like Mongo Santa Maria's Watermelon Man. Latin Boogaloo added more. Joe Cuba's Bang Bang.
I like it like that.
Pete Rodriguez's I Like It Like That. The musical simplicity of Latin Boogaloo, compared to the sophisticated mambos of the past, invited a new generation of musicians into the business.
If you played with Puente, or if you played with some of the other bands, Machito and stuff like that, you had to be, you know, really mature and kicking around for a long time. But now, you have this wave of young musicians coming in.
One of those was Joe Batan, a 22-year-old just out of prison.
And I remember walking down First Avenue and 99th Street, and I said to myself, I'm gonna start a band, and I'm gonna kick ass.
I took the subway downtown one day just to buy me some Chinese food. And then she smacked me on the head, kicked me on my head, said, "This is your dad, it's just me." Hey.
He put in the clapping, of course, which was very instrumental in most of the Boogaloo songs back then, and just to cause excitement.
Latin Boogaloo opened the doors for a band leader from the South Bronx who would stand at the center of the salsa revolution of the 70s. Trombonist Willie Colon.
We really sounded awful. It was, you know, just noisy, awful bands, but the kids loved it. We had a fan club. They would dance at the rehearsals. They would show up at the dances. So they were always there. So we started getting gigs just because we had this giant entourage that would show up all the time.
By 1967, Colon had a record deal with a local label. But there was a catch. Colon would have to take on a new lead singer, a Puerto Rican who had moved to New York only a few years earlier, Hector Lavoe.
So we talked to Hector. Hector decided he was gonna sing just this one album with us because the band, he said the band stunk.
Baby, I mean baby, I need you. Oh, you'll be fine.
We worked together for 8 years. I never officially hired him. I said, hey, what are you doing Saturday? He'd show up.
Baby, oh, really, baby.
Willie Colon's debut album, El Malo, was a hit in El Barrio and a boost to a young record label started in the city just a few years earlier, Fania Records. Fania's co-founder and musical director was Dominican Johnny Pacheco. He was making money off Boogaloo, but as a musician, didn't think much of the trend.
I used to hate it because, like, the trombone players, all they played was three notes and a backbeat, and to me that wasn't music. And they all sound the same. It was horrendous.
Pacheco had cut his teeth playing in New York's Latin orchestras in the 50s. In the early 60s, inspired by Cuban music, he led his own group featuring flute and violins. Though he had some hit LPs, he didn't think he was getting his fair share of the royalties and decided to start his own label, delivering the records himself.
I had a 180 Mercedes that was, the back was already hitting the floor. I was hitting the streets. And I used to load the trunk with records. And then we used to go into New York and part of the Bronx.
To help finance the label, Pacheco joined forces with a young Italian-American lawyer and ex-New York cop, Jerry Masucci.
He was having trouble with his first wife. He was paying a lot of money alimony, was very unhappy, and he gave me the case.
We hit it off, and I told him I wanted to start a company.
Without the two of them, it never would have happened. You know, Jerry couldn't have done it without Johnny. Johnny couldn't have done it without Jerry. It wouldn't have happened.
Pacheco and Masucci would combine the raw energy of Boogaloo with the skills and rhythms of older Cuban dance bands.
Oh,
Hispania planned to attract a new generation of Latinos in search of a new identity.
We were at that time as Puerto Ricans wanting to be bad. We wanted to be tough. And Superfly was out.
This dude is bad. And he ain't just fly. He's Superfly. Yeah. Superfly.
And Shaft and all of that stuff.
You say this cat is a bad mouse.
Shut your mouth.
You talking about Shaft?
Then we can dig it.
And we wanted to be part of that. So Willie, a working class Puerto Rican kid, took the image of the gangster and exploited it.
The clothes I was wearing and that gangster thing kind of played into the image, and it really caught on. It gave us an opportunity to do things with the covers that were interesting, and we would kind of parallel what was going on. We did The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, and The Hustler, the movie with Paul Newman. We do The Untouchables. So it was kind of a mirror of what was going on in the media in those days.
Graphic artist and concert MC Izzy Sanabria would design some of the most memorable Fania album covers and posters.
I came up with this idea, which was influenced by the fact that I had seen on sale posters by the FBI of Bobby Seale and, you know, some of the Black Panthers.
It looked exactly like a post office wanted poster, and we took like 20,000 of them and we put them around the city. We glued them all over the place. And people that didn't speak a lot of English, or, you know, they were calling up the FBI to find out how much the reward was.
Willie Colon's grandmother almost had a heart attack because her neighbors came in. Ah, tú no sabes que la FBI está buscando a Willie. You know, and Willie had to come in and tell, no, this is just a promotion in my album.
We were like a self-promoting merchandising machine, and it was all just organic because we were playing.
Colon's music had evolved as well. He had moved away from Boogaloo toward a more Latin sound that played to the strengths of singer Hector Lavoe.
In all of Hector's recordings, he was able to play with the rhythm and put the words in the way they fit, you know. You could give him the words and he would just kind of rock them around and wrap them around the rhythm and make it happen.
Lavoe sang with the full flavor of rural Puerto Rico. He was from the countryside, a jíbaro, and proud of it.
He was the most popular of all the singers in Fania because he was a real Puerto Rican, the real jíbarito. And he said, that's me, and that's the way I'm gonna be. And the people loved that.
We kept working together, and finally we got this, you know, chemistry. Where I really got to know him and understand him, and I learned a lot from him.
By the early 70s, Colon's growing sense of Puerto Rican pride had led him in a new experimental direction, integrating the folk traditions of the island into his music.
I had a string of hits already with Hector, and I go to Jerry at his new big office at 888 7th Avenue. To the Fania suite, go into his office, and I said, Jerry, I want to do a Christmas album. Great, great idea. I said, yeah, but I want to do a Christmas jíbaro album. I want to do Puerto Rican music. And he says, yeah, just bring me the record. I don't have time. And I said, okay, great.
To add an authentic jíbaro feel to the album, Colon wanted the instrument most identified with the Puerto Rican countryside, the cuatro. He called on Yomo Toro, a musician he had first heard as a boy while visiting his mother at her job in a lingerie shop in El Barrio.
I'd be in the store visiting and, you know, somebody would come in to buy underwear. I'd have to go out because it's, you know, a little personal. And I walked a couple of stores down and I saw this bar, the Campana Bar. And in in the window of the Campana Bar said Yomo Toro, Fridays. And I look and I hear a guy, you know, I hear the cuatro playing and stuff go inside with the go-go girls, and I'm trying to peek inside, and usually somebody would come out and, hey, get away from there, because I was just a little kid. I think I'm trying to see the go-go girls, but I wanted to, both.
Colón's Asalto Navideño, Christmas Assault, with its traditional and New Yorican sounds, would become one of Fania's biggest albums, selling well in New York, Puerto Rico, and breaking new ground for the label in South America. One track would become a classic, La Murga.
Vamos a bailar la murga.
Murga was based on a riff picked up while on tour in Panama.
It's been sampled and copied and stuff on a zillion records. It goes...
While in Panama, Colón and Laveau had left a deep impression on a young musician who would eventually take salsa in an entirely new direction.
We had this raw power, energy, and we all went, whoa.
Blades tried to sell them some of his songs. Laveau said to call him at his hotel.
I couldn't sleep at night. I was so thrilled. And of course, I call him at 8 o'clock in the morning. You know, he probably played till 3, 4, and then partied, and he's just gone to bed. And he picked up the phone, and I introduced myself, and he said, "Oh yeah, listen, brother, can you give me a little chance? 'Cause I'm gonna go to sleep now." And I said, "Oh yeah, yeah, I'm sorry." We said, you know, we'll meet some other time, and as it turns out that I did.
By the early 70s, Fania was set to explode. The catalyst was a single night's concert in a former roller skating rink in Midtown Manhattan, the Cheetah Club. The label had gathered its best talent to create the Fania All-Stars, led by Johnny Pacheco. They were a supergroup, the cream of New York's Latin scene, though they didn't sound like it at the afternoon's rehearsal.
That day, when they were rehearsing, it was horrendous. And we were saying, this is going to be terrible.
It was like a corral full of peacocks, really. It was not easy. The egos, I remember that I brought a chart that Hector and I had written. I won't say who did it, but one of the old-timers took it and threw it on the floor, and we couldn't play it, so I was very pissed. But Jerry said, "Ah, take it easy, Willie, go ahead." So I went and I played. And we did it, and it was great.
The place was completely packed, you know. The police and firemen came, you know, they blocked, you know, people couldn't get in. There was a line around the block, boom.
After the third number, we knew it was a happening.
That was one of the most amazing nights that you could ever witness in music.
That night at the Cheetah has been called the birth of salsa. It was the moment when many strands of music converged in New York to create the Latin sound of the 70s.
We'll be right back.
was Cuban music that we took and we changed the arrangements. Being that most of the guys were born here or grew up in New York, we had the rock influence, the jazz influence, and we changed the approach. And it was a New York sound. Now what happened was people were getting confused with the mambo, cha-cha-cha, guaracha. So what we did was took the music and put it under one roof, and we called it salsa.
A typical salsa band features one lead vocalist. That night, the All-Stars had six.
The energy from the stage and the energy from the audience created what I call an incredible spiritual, religious revival meeting of, you know, it was just something that started somewhere in the depths of your stomach through your emotions and your feet, and people couldn't sit. They wanted to stand up and dance in the aisles. For the people themselves, the audience, salsa's rhythms provided an escape from everyday life in their body. It became a rhythm they lived by, a rhythm they breathed, and a rhythm they made love to. It was the essence of the Latino soul.
The magic of that night at the Cheetah Club might have dissipated, except for another bold stroke by Masucci. He filmed the event.
He was just thinking just out of the box. You know, this is not, there was, nobody was investing this kind of money. Nobody had these kind of dreams.
What the Woodstock movie did for rock, Fania's Our Latin Thing did for salsa. It gave a glimpse into the lives of New Yorkers, propelled by the performance at the Cheetah Club. The film played to packed houses in cities around the U.S. and throughout the Americas.
It was a big success, you know, it was a tremendous success. And actually, it changed the whole business, because from just recording stars, you know, they became big images on a screen, and I believe it turned the whole business around. I think that's one of the things that made Fania the big success it is today.
Fania began cranking out new recordings while buying out smaller competing labels, on its way to becoming the only game in town in Latin music.
Motown had their music, the whites, the Anglo had their own music, and the Latinos, they said, this is our music. Salsa is our music. So they had something that they belongs to them.
Cinefox, domingo. Quieren salir de la rutina haciéndose pasar por otros.
I want tonight to be different, you know?
Triple Horn?
Us. We are the Triple Horn.
Y después...
No, wait, but that is not...
Hey, my wallet.
No, stop it. My...
Move.
Okay.
Quieren salir del lío en el que se metieron. Steve Carell, Tina Fey, Date Night. Mañana, por Cinefox.
Fox parties.
As Fania record sales soared, so the reputation of its boss began to sink.
He was the worst. He was a businessman. It was a one-sided thing. I mean, all the contracts that we signed were very wisely designed by Jerry and his lawyers, and we got the short end of the stick. All of us.
Jerry was a businessman. He was a businessman. And businessmen do what they do. He ain't taking the least of the profits, that's for sure. And there's no reason why he should, because he's the guy who's putting up the money and he's the guy who's taking a risk.
As long as I have the hits and the artists, I'm in a powerful position. But I've been lucky enough to know the right talent and sign them and keep them. And, you know, and after 15 years in the business and bringing the business up from nothing, you get a certain amount of power.
Masucci kept a tight rein on royalties. Even Fania's most prolific composer, Tite Curet Alonso, with over 300 hits, had to double as a mailman to make ends meet.
He wrote all the hits for everybody, and he died a pauper. And that's a shame, because he was a creator, he was a master, he was the guy that did made us all stars.
But whatever Masucci's business methods, his vision and his instinct for the music were seldom in question.
He was very smart. I used to bring him my record, and he'd say, which song do you think was the best song on here? I'd say, this one, song A. And he's going, no, it's song C. And 99% of the time, he was right. He would pick the hits.
By the early 70s, salsa was booming in New York. A vibrant soundtrack to the lives of millions. After the success of Our Latin Thing, Masucci was ready to make a second film. He took a high-risk gamble on an ambitious venue.
I decided to rent Yankee Stadium. It was $280,000 for the night. And everybody in New York told me I was totally crazy.
And that was Jerry. That was 100% Jerry. I even thought he was nuts. I'll never forget, we put $50,000 down on the field, you know? 50 grand as a deposit.
The Masucci brothers were guaranteeing with their own money the crowd would not damage the Yankees' valuable turf. That is, if a Latin audience could ever fill a stadium of this size.
I'll never forget, I went there sitting on pitches Mount Yankee Stadium, I'm looking up and nobody in the stadium, and all of a sudden they started to come, and then we had about 45,000 people there that night.
After a series of opening acts, Fania brought out the all-stars in a roll call of its best talent.
Otro gran boricua, Chero Feliciano.
With the film shoot underway and over 40,000 people in the stands, the night appeared to be a success.
Johnny was leading the band, and the band, you know, they're playing Congo Bongo, and Mongo is playing, and Barretto's playing, and the drums playing, and I'm looking, and I'm saying, what the f- is that? And it looked like a waterfall. Something was moving from the loge down, and I realized that's people. These people are climbing down onto the field, and they're charging the stage, and Johnny don't see it, the band don't see it, and all I'm thinking about is that's 50 grand that we're gonna lose. And I'm trying to stop the show. You know the guy who's going, cut, cut, and that was me. They went right over the stage. They stole the piano. They stole the timbales, you know? the bodyguards picked up Jerry and started carrying him away. And it was pretty much of a riot, you know? So depressed. I took the money and I went home. Jerry said, what are you gonna do? I said, I'm gonna go home. I'll take the money. And I took all these suitcases with the money in it. And I went home.
The crowd's favorite, Hector Lavoe, was left in the changing rooms, unable to perform. As Fania's top male star, he had to be in that expensive salsa film. So a year later, Masucci took him all the way to Puerto Rico and filmed him there. This performance turned Mi Gente, My People, into a salsa anthem. Fania's rise to the top of the Latin scene had started in the streets, but at the same concert in Puerto Rico, Masucci presented the new dazzling jewel he had recently added to the Fania crown, the legendary Cuban singer, Celia Cruz.
She had a powerful voice. She had everything. She had that African heritage. And that's what she exposed. She was rhythm. She was salsa.
Cruz's story reached back to the radio stations of 1940s Cuba.
I just always loved Celia. And I really wanted her to come and to our label.
Jerry went wild for Celia. You know, he went wild for Celia.
By bringing Cruz to the label, Masucci introduced the star to a new generation. And Fania gained not only a singular talent, but some old school showbiz glamour. Finally completed after 2 years, the second film attempted to take the music out of El Barrio and place it in the middle of mainstream pop culture. Jorge Santana, Carlos's brother, added rock guitar. Mongo Santa Maria, well known in the jazz and pop world, was featured. Cameroonian Manu Dibango played his R&B and pop hit, Sol Makossa.
Latin music has always been for dancing.
And hip New York reporter Geraldo Rivera added commentary.
Now if the music is hot and the beat is up-tempo, there's only one name for it. The name is salsa.
But the critical and commercial response to the film in the U.S. was tepid. Ultimately, where the label struck gold was outside of the United States.
See you.
Okay. By the mid-70s, the Fania All-Stars with Celia Cruz were touring the world, ambassadors of salsa, developing markets and fueling an explosion in Fania's international sales.
When we were really doing the great concerts with the Fania All-Stars, we would do more business in Latin America than the Rolling Stones. We had the president and the generals of Panama meeting us at the airplanes with Fania All-Star buttons on. Ridiculous. They used to tear the doors down, metal doors down, to get in. We did Japan, we did Africa, we did England, we did all of South America. And wherever we went, we never had a loser. It was always big.
The All-Stars were on the crest of a Latin wave, touring and indulging like rock stars.
We had Rolling Stone and Crawdaddy and all kind of rock and roll magazines and stuff covering us, and so we understood it was something else. But it was nuts. The Fania All-Stars was, you know, all of these guys are geniuses, and by the same token, they're just mad, crazy mad. But it was great. It worked. It elevated a lot of us to a position where we could really earn a living at this, a respectable living, and I think it created a market that just wasn't there before.
Fania had become an international juggernaut, with Jerry Masucci riding high at the top. But its greatest success was still to come. The once awestruck Panamanian musician, Ruben Blades, had moved to New York in 1974, leaving behind a career as an attorney. He'd called Fania hoping to record for the label, but been turned down flat.
Before I hung up, I said, is there anything else you have there? Is there any kind of job of it? The person said, well, you have an opening in the mailroom. And how much does it pay? $125 a week. And I said, I'll take it. But everybody thought I was crazy, I think, in a way, because I was a lawyer, an attorney, and I'm working in a mailroom, you know.
Blade's strategy paid off. In partnership with Willie Colon, he recorded his first Fania album, introducing a new lyrical sophistication to salsa. Blades provided the songs, with Colon producing the recordings.
Willie Colon has this ability to connect and reconcile the artistic with the commercial. He knows how to do that instinctively. Very intuitive person.
Ruben had a talent for putting together words, for crafting the words in such a way that he was able to just paint a picture of so that you could hear and smell and see all of the things within the lyric.
When I got to New York, for instance, I wrote this song. Apúrate, maquinista, que de hace tiempo estoy esperando el número seis. El número seis. El número seis. What is that song about? It's a subway. Hurry up, damn machine. I've been here for hours and still I cannot see the number six subway. Number six. And people still sing it today. Why? Because today you still have people waiting for the number six train and saying, where the hell is this train?
Apúrate, maquinista, que hace tiempo estoy esperando el número seis. El número seis. El número seis. El número seis.
Then he starts writing lyrics that have political and social content. And he deeply penetrates South America.
When I started writing songs about things that happened to people in the city, then people who were not dancers and people who were not from the barrio itself or that corner specifically and began to adapt the songs as their own. It's not just to dance, too. This is more important. This can go beyond dictatorships and beyond censorships, beyond ignorance. It could also be a way of solidarity, not just dancing.
Blade's songwriting and Colon's production combined to create an album that has been called the Sgt. Pepper of Salsa, Siembra.
If an album sold 10,000 copies, it was, you know, if it sold 40,000, which was what Willie was doing at the time, was, well, and if it sold 100,000, it was like unbelievably huge success.
Las manos siempre en los bolsillos de su gabán.
When we sold 500,000 copies of Siembra in Caracas, Venezuela alone, that was like an earthquake.
And it just came at the right moment. There was problems in Panama, there was problems in the universities in Puerto Rico, all of these political problems, and here comes Siembra, boom.
Ironically, the Pan-American success of Siembra was the beginning of the end of Fania's domination of salsa. New outposts of production sprang up throughout Latin America. Back in New York, the creative team of Blades and Colon was falling apart.
On a personal level, we didn't connect at all. Because Ruben is a guy that was raised by his mom and dad, and he went to the university, and he decided to come to New York and dabble, you know, in the ghettos and do the music. So he understood everything intellectually, but he didn't know what it really is, you know. And I'm a guy that was raised, you know, with holes in his shoes and el barrio. It was very hard for us to work together.
Another Fania star, Hector Lavoe, was in trouble. For years, he had struggled with drug addiction, which now began to get the upper hand.
Because of his drug use, he was beginning not to show up in the shows, and his voice was beginning to suffer, and his sales began to drag. And when that happened, Jerry Masucci called me, and I'm sure he called Willie too, and said, we need to do something with Hector. You got something, it's gotta be great.
Blades gave Lavoe a song he had written for himself, a portrait tinged with sadness of a singer, El Cantante. It would become Lavoe's signature song.
Yo soy el cantante, muy popular donde quiera, pero cuando el show se acaba, soy otro humano cualquiera.
And he did well with that album. But then, you know, what a tragic life he had. It's such a sad thing.
I was able to help him a lot at the beginning, but when it got too strong, you know, there's just, you know, I had to let go.
He wanted to get out of it, but it was hard. It was hard. So things got so bad that he ended up the way he did. He was a great guy.
Hector Lavoe would die of AIDS in 1993.
Towards the end of the 70s, The Fania family was starting to fall apart. Masucci had bought his own pressing plant, which means we didn't know how many records he was pressing, which means we didn't know how many records were being sold. All the singers were leaving and forming their own bands.
It's like a baseball team, you know. If you're a winning manager, and you're powerful, but once the team starts losing, you're only as good as your players, you know.
You talk about rock and roll, you know, you have one group, you make millions of dollars. You know, Jerry had 35 groups that he had to listen to every day and listen to their problems and listen to about the cockroaches and listen about their kids and listen about, you know, I think he just said, "F it," you know? I think he just said, "F it, I'm getting out of here."
They weigh you down. And I just wanted to get away and take a break. You know, burnt out, you know, that's that thing. I was burnt out.
Fania was a movement. They saw themselves as a business-making entity, as a profit-making entity, but it was a movement. Fania produced, supported, encouraged some of the finest musicians in our country.
We became kings. We were the kings. Our salsa music, and specifically the Fania All-Stars, we were the kings.
It was so much fun. It was just so much fun. They were all nuts, you know, and they were young, they were all stars. You know, to me, they were all family.
We said at the beginning we're gonna take over the world, and we did. We did.
Ahora comienza Fox HD.
Futurama. Si tú no lo ves, alguien más